Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Mary Price. I'm the Events and Marketing Director at the Shingo Institute at Utah State University. Today, I'm excited to have Jim Huntzinger with us. Jim is the founder of Lean Frontiers. He's held diverse roles in engineering, operations, and management, focusing on implementing and involving lean practices in small, privately held to global corporations. This month's newsletter, which was sent out earlier this week, featured an article written by Jim. It's titled "The Foundational Skills of a Continuous Improvement Culture." You can access that article on our website if you don't receive the newsletter. Just go to shingo.org, click the media tab, and select the blog. As a reminder, all of our monthly webinars can be found on our YouTube channel. You can also listen to the Shingo Principles podcast. You can access both of those directly from the website under the media tab as well. Jim, once again, thank you for being here. I'm excited to learn more about training within industry. Thank you.
All right. Again, thank you very much, Mary. And I'd also like to thank Helen, Zach, and Mary of the Shingo Institute for their help in getting ready and prepared for this webinar. So yeah, what I was going to talk to you today about are the foundational skills of a continuous improvement culture. I'm going to go through a couple of little stories to kind of set it up, and then I'll get into talking about those skills a bit, kind of a high level overview of what those are and some of the background with them as well. But first, before I get started, I certainly want to talk to you about the Shingo model. As you can see here, as it says, and for this from the website, it's not just another initiative, it's a new way of thinking. So if you look at the model, obviously it has systems, the tools, kind of produce up the results. And, you know, all those are kind of tied into the guiding principles. Sometimes I say organizational objectives, and they circle around that. And in the center, you see there is culture. And I like that it has behavior in there, because that's really what we're going to be talking about today. And with these skills I'm going to talk about in the behavior, it is very much interwoven with this entire model. So keep this model in mind as we go through this, because these skills impact the systems from developing them, sustaining them, improving them. Same thing with the tools, getting you the results that align with the guiding principles or organizational objectives. And essentially, those behavior patterns are the culture that develops. So what I like to say too is not just a new way of thinking, but to go through a new way of behaving through these foundational skills. So like I said, I want to start off with a couple, I guess, stories and all that first. So first, hopefully a lot of you recall the movie, The Karate Kid, the original one from the 1980s. So in it, the story, the boy that's kind of the star of the movie, Daniel, he moves from the East Coast out to the West Coast, kind of gets in a kind of a tussle with some boys there when he moves out to California. They kind of get in fights with him. They kind of beat him up, and they know karate. And he meets this gentleman by the name of Mr. Miyagi, who happens to be kind of the maintenance manager of the apartment complex he lives in. And he finds out that Mr. Miyagi knows karate. So he tries to get Mr. Miyagi to teach him karate so he can, fight back on these boys. And finally, Mr. Miyagi agrees to it under one condition. And that condition is that Daniel does everything he tells him to do, you know, without hesitation. Daniel finally agrees to it. And that's where they get into the part where Mr. Miyagi has a small set of old model cars, actually beautiful cars. And he asks Daniel to wash them. And then after he washes them, he asks him to wax him, which gets into the kind of the mantra of the movie, the wax on, wax off. So Daniel does that, wax on, wax off. After he finishes with that, Mr. Miyagi wants him to paint a fence. Okay, Daniel says, yeah, not quite sure what this has to do with karate, but he paints a fence, goes in his backyard, and he has a fence all the way around it. So he has to paint the fence, and it's, you know, paint up, paint down, paint up, paint down. And Daniel gets pretty frustrated with it because he's going, what the heck does this have to do with karate? But what it does have to do is what Mr. Miyagi's doing is teaching him particular skills, some base fundamental skills of karate. And this kind of leads into this. What we really want to do, and kind of the learning point here, is you want to teach these skills so you can utilize them without thinking about it. Make them habits. And you only learn skills or make them habitual skills. They're developed through practice, and I'll emphasize that throughout practice. And that's what Mr. Miyagi's doing, practicing the wax on, wax off, the paint up, paint down. And you notice Mr. Miyagi just gives him short little corrections, short little hints, no real long diatribes, and kind of coaching him through these fundamental skills. And then you see at the kind of the end of the movie in the climax in the fight scene where Daniel now has these skills, these movements where they're just habitual. So the other thing that does not only does it make you learn these skills and learn them correctly, which is important, but it also frees up your mind to think about the more complexities of the circumstance you're in without having to think about these skills and essentially these habits. And that's what we want to do. So think of this through it. So with this, we'll jump over to this slide. So what this says is learn by doing. So learn by doing, you hear that from kind of a, I guess, a Toyota-ish standpoint. They'll say that. Now, the learn by doing comment actually came from the TWI, Training with an Industry program that was developed during World War II, and we're going to talk about that a bit. But reason I'm pointing this up is if you go into Toyota or one of those companies, they don't go, okay, let me send you to this class, go to this class, you'll learn how to do this stuff, then you'll come back and you'll know this Toyota stuff or whatever it is. What they really do is they go, let's go work on a project together. And by together, it's you and your manager or supervisor will work on a project together. And what that means is like the little cartoon. You see the little cartoon at the bottom of the slide. That's actually from John Shook, who worked for Toyota for many years. And actually, I got this from years ago. And that kind of illustrates this role is the supervisor, the manager is there to help bring you along. Let's go do a project together on real work, real life stuff. And I will guide you, coach you, direct you, ask you questions. I won't answer things for you very much. I won't tell you how to do it, but I will help guide you, help you walk up that path. Let's go do it together. That's the learn by doing. So again, keep that in mind as we go through this as well. That's an important key. And finally, another story about John Shook. So John Shook, I think when he went into college, I think it was in the late 70s or so, something like that. And he realized there's some phenomenon going on in Japan and he wanted to be a part of it. So I forget what his graduate undergraduate work was, but one thing he did take was Japanese. So he became fluent in Japanese, flew over to Japan and started knocking on doors at companies. Well, at that time, I think late 70s, early 80s, Japanese companies weren't really big on hiring foreigners. So you knock on the door and they'd say, thanks, but no thanks. We don't really hire foreigners. Well, at the same time that's going on, Toyota and General Motors were in discussions about doing a joint venture. That joint venture would eventually become the NUMMI plant in Fremont, California. And it was the Fremont plant, a little background on that, was the Fremont plant and General Motors had been one of General Motors' worst, if not the worst plant for decades. Poor productivity, poor quality, strikes, wildcat strikes, it just been a mess. And prior to this joint venture, actually, General Motors had actually shut down the plant. So when they brought the joint venture together, and essentially GM was gonna provide the capital, the plant, quit some equipment, and the people. So these terrible union people, I think it's 90, 95% of these terrible union people were hired back to work at the plant. And Toyota's part of the deal was they were gonna manage the plant. So when John knocked on Toyota's door, they're like, we got this joint venture in the US. Maybe we need an American. So they jerked him in the door and said, yep, we'll hire you to be part of that project. Now, one of the first things John did was he had to take some Japanese, because he's fluent in Japanese training material and translate it into English. And as he was doing that, you know, he's reading through it, translating in English, thinking, oh my gosh, Americans aren't going to do this stuff. And he started this discussion. I think it really got into somewhat of an argument with his manager, Japanese manager, said, hey, listen, Americans aren't going to do this. This stuff is too rote. Americans aren't going to be willing to do this. And the manager said, we'll keep translating. This is what we're going to use. So this went on for a little while. And John said, finally, one day after the arguments, his manager was a little bit frustrated, came in to where John was working, slammed this old booklet down in front of him and said, don't tell me Americans won't do this. And what this was TWI job instruction manual. And John said it was all coffee stained and dog eared. And his manager said, don't tell me Americans aren't willing to do this. This is where we got it from. So that was pretty enlightening to John. So on that plant, as Toyota comes in, they ramp it up and bring all these terrible union people in. Within, I think, about 18 months, that plant was one of the most productive plants in General Motors, if not the most productive plant. So this difference in management, this being part of how they bring these people up to speed, is important. So with that, I've done a lot of work in history, is a majority of things we think as Japanese management were actually things that were developed in the U.S. and brought over to Japan, in this case, is during the occupation, post-war in Japan, to help Japan rebuild their industry. TWI was one of a number of things. So most of the stuff was developed in the United States and brought over. Now, that's notwithstanding somebody like Toyota, who brought that stuff in, internalized it, developed it, continue with it today, and did a lot of work, not taking any credit from them, but a lot of this supposed Japanese management stuff wasn't at the beginning. So to move into some of these skills a little bit, what I'm showing this slide is, because I talked about TWI. So TWI, Training Within Industries, is a program developed during World War II, actually to help the United States ramp up our armaments production at a time when we had the most need of manufacturing in the U.S. And at the same time, we had all these green people, because we sent the boys overseas to fight, all these green people that had never been involved in industry coming into, at the time, we're ramping up more than we ever have in history. And that's where Rosie the Riveter came from. And the TWI program was one of the programs they developed first to train these people who had never been involved in industry very quickly and rapidly. I just want to go through this a little bit with the point here. So the little bit of history of the job instruction, it actually ties back to, as all these do, have a long history, usually not decades long and often centuries and millennia long. So it's not something new. These things have been around for a long time. The job instruction was originally developed as a five-step method by a German philosopher educator named Johann Herbert in the early 1800s. There are American Herbatians is what they were called, and also European Herbatians. One of the American Herbatians was a guy named Charles Allen. He was a vocational trainer in the late 1800s, early 1900s, went by the nickname Skipper Allen. And he took Herbert's five-step methodology and developed into a four-step methodology, which he called job instruction. And he actually wrote a book in 1919, almost 500 pages of just on the four-step methodology. It's also based on the scientific method, the job instruction. So of the four guys that led up that program during the war, one of them had worked for Allen directly. Two of the other ones had been trained by Allen late 19-teens, early 1920s. They brought that forward in the job instruction that Allen had and put it into a format, kept the same methodology that Allen had, but put in a format to deploy it all across the U.S. because they didn't know the people, they had to make it bulletproof. So whether people had no skills in training, a little bit or a lot, it would be effective. And that's what they did. They also developed job methods, which is also based on a scientific method and the same delivery format that they developed for job instruction to make improvements. And it has deep roots in industrial engineering. And also, finally, job relations, which is about leadership for supervisors, for leaders, on how you deal with people problems, all based on the four-step methodology. So the reason for this chart, just to show how all these are a scientific method, you can see on there, plan, do, check, act, the Shewhart-Deming cycle, also scientific method. And of course, there in the one column, scientific method. And look at Toyota Kata. It also, too, is based on the four steps of the scientific method. So that's why these things are so powerful and so effective. They're all based on a scientific method. And their roots go back, like I said, decades, centuries, actually all the way back to the scientific method. We could trace back to the 4th century BC under Aristotle, and more in a modern way we use it today, back to Sir Francis Bacon in the late 1500s, early 1600s. So these are very, very tried and true methods, which is why they're so effective and powerful. And essentially, this is what Toyota was doing or does do to this day. So a couple points on it. Critical points are, one is, in doing these skills, they need to be aligned with the organizational objectives and needs. There's all kinds of improvements we can make, but we really want to align the improvements utilizing these skills with our organizational objectives. Like if you look back at the Shingo model, those guiding principles, what is the organization trying to accomplish? And also too, you want to do it through deliberate practice, and not only deliberate practice, but practicing with intention. And I'll just kind of read this to you because this is what this really means, is deliberate practice is crucial to success and means of practicing daily to make skills a habit of applying scientific thinking and behavior, like we talked about up front, wax on, wax off. So deliberately practicing all these skills, the TWI, the Kata skills, skills, routines, and habits in conjunction with each other, and we'll talk about that more in a bit, is essential to developing and building a culture of continuous improvement for the short term, daily, and for the long term. That's what I mean by this stuff's interwoven through the Shingo model, from looking at the systems, the tools, getting results aligned with the guiding principles or organizational needs. So I'll jump in a little bit on Toyota Kata. So when Mike wrote the book Toyota Kata in 2009, my favorite diagram in there was this one about the unclear territory, where what it's saying there is you want to get to this target condition, as a list out, you know, sometimes they'll call it a challenge in the Kata talk, you know, future state from value stream mapping, target condition you want to get to. So it's only partially objective. But you also, in order to do that, you need to know what your current condition is, current state. Like if you're driving to Atlanta and you want to map that out, you need to know, are we starting from Indianapolis? Are we starting from Boise, Idaho? Where are we starting from in order to map it out? But in order to get from where you're currently at to this target condition, you go through an unclear territory. Traditionally, we usually set up the products or whatever it is. We set up a straight line with some toll gates and all that, and we think we're going to walk across there. That projects or doing things never goes that way. We always hit challenges or unexpected things or things we just don't know about getting there. That's what these skills are for, traversing that unclear territory successfully. And that's where the term trust the process comes in. We'll talk about it. So taking a look at the Kata, the improvement Kata, the improvement routine with it. Again, four steps to the scientific method, like I talked about even in the unclear territory diagram. You know, what's our target condition? What's the direction or challenge? Sometimes use that phrase that we want to get to, but what's our current condition? So that's really important to really grasp and understand your current condition. By observation, for those of you familiar about the Ono circle and things like that, that's what that was for. Go really, truly understand the current condition. Go observe, go ask questions, and grasp that current condition. Now, you're not going to jump all the way to the challenge. You're going to have to make iterative steps to what the next target condition is. And that's what you do through conducting experiments. Again, so in a sense, with the improvement Kata, it's really the scientific method with a series of scientific methods built into it to get you there, to iterate yourself, to go through that process, to create this scientific mindset and the scientific pattern of behavior. So with that, we also have the coaching Kata. So the reason for the coaching Kata, again, same basic diagram. And you can see in a way, John Shook's little cartoon is somewhat laid over this by the cartoon on there, is a student or you, and then your coach, your trainer, your hopefully your supervisor, manager helps mentor you up through that using what's called the coaching Kata, which is a series of questions help you think and analyze in a scientific way to keep you in line. Again, he's not going to answer things for you, but help guide you to, so you can go through that work of running these experiments. And what's known as a threshold of knowledge. Remember, we're in an unclear territory. So you have a certain threshold of knowledge. And the only way to move beyond that is to run experiments, is to learn, is to have a hypothesis, see how your experiment hits it, doesn't hit it, hits it in part, and reiterate. And the coach, the mentor, your supervisor is there to help you that. Let's go do a project together. And you increase your threshold of knowledge. Another thing to keep in mind is your coach or your supervisor, whatever, he very well may not, he probably doesn't know all the answers either. So this is a dual learning process, learning the steps and execution of the improvement Kata, the coaching Kata, and also learning and improving the threshold of knowledge for both the people, the coach and the coachee. And that's how you iterate up to your next target condition or ultimately your challenge or your final target condition. So this slide I want to go through, and this is a high level view. So this is really talking through at a high level how all these different skills, really they're all kata. And kata is just a word that comes out of Japanese martial arts, kind of like Mr. Miyagi was teaching to Daniel. He was teaching him katas, wax on, wax off, paint up, paint down. These are kata. So if you look at all the TWIJ programs, JI, JM, JR, the Toyota Kata, Coaching Kata Improvement, they're all katas to help you think and behave with a scientific mind. So with that, when you're starting out, is first when you come into a situation, again, you want to go observe. Usually when you come into a place and looking at making improvements or whatever you want to do, first you got to do is really stabilize it. Often we find that in order to look at the bigger process, our sub processes actually aren't stable. So you use all these same skills to stabilize unstable processes in order just to set a groundwork, a stable baseline to begin your bigger improvement trajectory you want to get on, getting to your bigger challenge or target condition. So all these skills are utilized in that, just getting things stable. Something else I want to bring up is a lot of times I hear people or companies say, hey, should we start with standard work or should we start with Kaizen? You know, what should we start with? The answer is both, because these things must coexist. They're completely codependent on each other. We'll talk a little bit more about what that means from the skill standpoint as we go along. So let's say we use these skills to get things stabilized. And these aren't withstanding other improvement in techniques and Six Sigma techniques, depending on what the problem is. A lot of times you'll hear Toyota-ish type people go, you'll ask them, well, what will you do? No, I say, well, it depends. The depends means I need to get in there, observe and learn what the current condition is, your current state, before I can know what skill I need to apply. So we get it stabilized. So then we're okay. We have our current condition. We've got the initial thing reasonably stabilized. Then we're also looking, okay, we want to our target condition or future state. So again, we traverse this unclear territory and we run into obstacles. And we have this whole series of, you can say katas, routines, JI, JM, JR, the IK, improvement kata, CK, that we use to iterate through this process, to iterate through these obstacles, again, using the scientific method. And which one do we use? Well, it depends. It depends what circumstance we run into. One is maybe people can't do a particular process. Well, maybe the kata you need is job instruction to teach them an effective way, a standard way, a safe way to do the particular process. Maybe it's too hard. Well, maybe you need to hone in with job methods in order to make improvements on a particular process. Or maybe you need a bigger picture of using the improvement kata to do it. And actually people say, well, Toyota still uses JI and JR. Ono dropped JM. He didn't drop JM at all. JM is really the Kaizen aspect of these improvements. And the improvement, as Mike observed companies using these behavioral patterns, they all did a little bit differently, but he found these foundational underlying patterns they followed, which became the improvement kata and coaching kata. Those things are all derived out of these decades of Toyota utilizing, not exclusively, but these J skills. And as they moved up in the organization, they developed them to use them on bigger projects and other things that went on in the company. So you go through that using these skills to work your way iteratively through these obstacles. And again, standard work becomes a way to, as you make improvements, to keep yourself on that trajectory. If you think of traditionally most organizations, probably ones you've been in or are in, if you look when you did the improvement, the Kaizen workshops, your improvement trajectory kind of went like this and then arced off and kind of diminished some. These skills allow you to do it and stay on an upward trajectory, continuing forward. And as I said before, this is kind of a zoom in on that, on how, you know, job instruction stabilizes job methods and the improvement kind of help you make the improvement, restabilize with job instruction. And then also too, job relations give you an environment where you have a safe environment for you could do, you can experiment, you can do things incorrectly, but learn from them. And then of course, all these different coaching techniques like the coaching kata, humble inquiry for you, those that know Edward Schein, all those are techniques to help bring people along that path. So that's, like I said, was a quick overview, busy slide, but quick overview. So certain some of the objectives as we conclude here is one is you want to develop scientific thinking and behavior in your people at all levels. This is at all levels, not just the front line, at all levels. And the J programs, the kata, improvement and coaching kata and good coaching habits are all skills to help you do that. And the other key point, objective, is you don't think your way to a new practice or behavior. You practice your way to a new way of thinking. So we like to say there's four steps in this with any of these. The first one is practice. The second one is practice. The third one is practice. The fourth one is go back up to the first one. You can't practice too much on any of this. So I'll leave you with this. And this really becomes kind of the, I guess, the gold mine for what this is these fundamental skills. And I like to say, if you're not using kata or TWI the same in 3 months, that's a problem. Again, because you're supposed to have a deliberate practice with intention. So you got to practice them so they become this habitual skill that you use. The other thing is, if you're using TWI and kata the same in 3 years, that's also a problem, because as these become habits and skills and you get experience with them, you should expand and grow the way you use them, like Toyota did. They use them in big projects, in management. They use this pattern of thinking that's derived out of these fundamental skills. So with that, because I know we're kind of getting close to our time, I'd like to conclude and thank you for all this. And if you want to learn more about it, certainly the Kata Summit, KataCon 10, and TWI Summit are coming up next month in April in Indianapolis. They actually are running concurrently, so if you register for one, you have full access to the other, and you can go learn, meet people that are doing these. So with that, thank you very much. And Mary, I'll turn it back over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We do have just a few minutes.
Okay.
For Q&A, if you have any questions, go ahead and ask that in the Q&A section right now. I am going to, while we're waiting for those questions, just highlight a few things as well. So I wanted to make everyone aware of a contest that we're holding. Anyone that registers and reserves a guest room for the 36th Annual Shingo Conference will be entered into a drawing for a suite upgrade. And we're also giving away a $50 gift card for some Shingo apparel on our store for those of you that like our page and reshare the event on social media. So if you don't already follow the Shingo Institute, you can find us on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. I just wanted to show you what the post looks like that I'm talking about. So this one is what's going to show up on Facebook and Instagram. And this is our LinkedIn page. And this is X. So hopefully you get a chance to go on there and like that. Looks like we do have a few questions now. Does kata and training within industry require a dojo?
I don't know about necessarily require them. That certainly can be helpful. There is a, and actually we're gonna have one going on at the Kata Summit, TWI Summit, a kata dojo. In a way, when you get trained on TWI, when you get trained on it, that really, in a sense, is a dojo, although we don't use that terminology in the training and practice of it.
Wonderful. Thank you. How much governance is needed with establishing a culture of continuous improvement?
I guess, again, I would say that really depends. It certainly needs some of it. It certainly has to be something, again, using the same terms, deliberate, intentional, that you're trying to do. Again, if you look at the Shingo model, I mean, in a way, it kind of illustrates some of that. You have to be very intentional and deliberate with what you're doing. But again, one thing that's really important is to align it with the organizational objectives. Otherwise, you're just kind of randomly kind of doing improvements here and there. You really want to align it with the objective, so you're doing it better for the betterment of the business. And that'll also help you align it with, that's where actually strategy deployment and Hoshin Kanri become important part of making it successful. So you want it to be deliberate and intentional.
Thank you. So most of your examples today came from manufacturing. Does this apply to education, healthcare software? Can you expand more on that?
Yes, and actually that's a great question. The simple answer, but a truthful answer, is anywhere you have people and processes, it applies. And that's pretty much in every industry of every type, education, business. So there are a lot of healthcare organizations, I think even some insurance organizations that are utilizing these skills.
Right. Okay. I think we are out of time. For those of you that have additional questions, we'll go ahead and forward those on to Jim, and he'll get back to you directly with the answers. Thank you again so much for attending, and thank you so much, Jim, for presenting today. We learned a lot. I appreciate your time.
All right, thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone.